Okay, so at the end of every single NFL season, one team alone defeats every other opponent in their way and takes home the Super Bowl trophy as a reward. But what about the other teams? What are we as fans to think about all those incredible teams, loaded with talent that for one reason or another fell just short of football's ultimate euphoria? So with that being said, in this video, we will tackle one question and one question only. Who is the greatest football team ever assembled that never won a Super Bowl? I will present you with three of the best teams to never win it all, and it will be up to you to decide who is the greatest team to never win the Super Bowl. Alright, so the first team we're going to be dissecting is the 1998 Vikings, and wow, I'm so surprised to see the Vikings on a list like this. When you get blue-balled with a Super Bowl ring as much as the Vikings have, the hardest part for me was simply picking which Minnesota team was worthy of this video. Anyways, I decided to settle on this 1998 Vikings team, and they were truly a special group and one that deserves to be remembered for forever. This Vikings team had 7 Pro Bowlers and 4 first team All-Pro members scattered across all sides of the ball. First of all, this team had nothing short of a revolutionary all-time great offense. For 8 straight years going into this season, wide receiver Chris Carter had been one of the most dominant and overall consistent wide receivers in the entire league, making 5 Pro Bowls in a row going into the 1998 season. And what the Hall of Fame wide receiver specialized in most was never dropping the ball, running fundamental but effective routes, and above all, demanding defense's attention as he opened up the field for his other receivers. Now, luckily for the Vikings, in the 1998 draft, a historic draft steal would fall right into their laps at the 21st selection. This player would be the perfect ingredient into the offense that head coach Dennis Green and offensive coordinator Brian Billick had been brewing for years. And finally, due to some controversies, college superstar Randy Moss was selected by the Minnesota Vikings. So, thank the Cowboys for straight up lying to Randy, Vikings. Good job, Jerry. So now going into the 1998 season, the Vikings had an unstoppable offense immediately. But then after 2 weeks, their starting quarterback, Brad Johnson, went down with an injury, which at the time looked like a curse, but much like the 1999 Rams, this injury unlocked the full potential of the Vikings offense. Because with Johnson out for the time being, this elevated Randall Cunningham to claim the starting job for himself. But this was not the Randall Cunningham you think you know. This version of Randall hadn't been an effective starting quarterback for the last 4 years, and lost a very noticeable amount of athleticism since his Philadelphia days. Or so we thought, because to understand this Vikings team, I'm gonna need you to throw all logic straight out the window, because Randall Cunningham at the ripe age of 35 in 1998 has by far the best season of his career, throwing for 3,700 yards and 34 touchdowns, both very close to league-leading statistics, at age 35. Anyway, this Vikings team led by an explosive offense that could score whenever with offensive rookie of the year and first team All-Pro Randy Moss, Pro Bowl running back and 1,000-yard rusher Randy Smith, and the aforementioned Chris Carter and Randall Cunningham also had one of the best defenses in the entire NFL, because hey, why not? This was an elite defense that allowed the 6th lowest points per game, led by elite linebacker play from Pro Bowler Ed McDaniel, the solid enough defensive back play from corners Jimmy Hitchcock and Corey Fuller, as well as safety Robert Griffith. But really, one man represented the entire heart and soul of that Vikings team, and that was first team All-Pro and raging psychopathic defensive end John Randall. So with Cunningham, Moss, and Carter lighting the league on fire, and Randall and others anchoring one of the league's best defenses, this was enough to claim the second best record of all time at 15-1 and the number one seed in the NFC. And after throttling the poor Cardinals in the divisional game, led by Randall Cunningham's 3 touchdowns, they move on to face their boogeyman in the NFC championship game, the Atlanta Falcons. And for most of the game, it was going okay for the Vikings. They did go into the game with an injured John Randall and were playing pretty sloppy mainly because of that. Also, a rookie Randy Moss was held to just 1 catch for the entire game after 9 minutes passed into the second quarter, which really took a hit on the offense's effectiveness. But regardless of all the ugly in this game, the Vikings, led by Cunningham and Randy Smith, got themselves into a position to ice the game with a simple kick and punch their ticket to the Super Bowl. Now hold on, pause for a second. Remember how I said the Vikings had All-Pro members scattered across all sides of the ball? Well, this is first team All-Pro kicker Gary Anderson, and he hasn't missed a kick in 122 attempts, so that's great. The Vikings should just nail this kick and walk into the Super Bowl with confidence and swagger, as the Vikings
and it's not good.
Tragic. absolutely tragic. Although the kicker isn't entirely to blame, this was a Vikings team that has a serious case as the most talented team maybe ever, and they never even made the Super Bowl. But even though this Vikings team truly does have a claim as the best team to never win it all, that doesn't mean the other teams didn't get closer. So it's time to talk about the most infamous team to never win the Super Bowl, the 2007 Patriots. So I'm sure most of you already know the basics of this team. They went undefeated in the regular season, going 16-0, and were led by the league's most dominant coach-quarterback duo of all time in Bill Belichick and Tom Brady. Not only that, but a common denominator from that Vikings team is also here, and better than ever, as Randy Moss had the best season of his entire career in his first year with the Patriots. Add on to that, arguably the best defense in the entire league, led by guys like first-team All-Pros in Mike Vrabel and Asante Samuel, and other great players like Richard Seymour, Teddy Bruschi, Junior Seau, and Rodney Harrison. Oh my god, they were loaded. So yeah, the year before, this Patriots team went 12-4. Then they decided to add Randy Moss and unleashed their wrath upon the league. During the season, the Patriots averaged a scorching 36.8 points per game, third most all time, all behind the MVP of the league in Tom Brady. And he had a pretty good year himself, as he ended up finishing the year throwing for nearly 5,000 yards, 50 touchdowns on 300 yards per game. Just unreal statistics. So with that perfect storm of everyone playing at their physical peaks, this made the 2007 Patriots only the second perfect team in NFL history, going 16-0. And not only did they go 16-0, but they convincingly slaughtered teams like cattle throughout the entire year. This Pats team was last in the league in possessions, meaning they had the ball less than any other team in the league, and at the exact same time, they had the most points per drive since the stat was tracked all the way back in 1991. And it doesn't stop there, because they were also first in the league in touchdowns, where they scored a touchdown on 50% of their drives. 50%! The league average at the time was 20%. This should just be illegal. And it damn near was, as during the regular season, they really only had a handful of truly close games, and had a 5-week stretch where they almost scored 50 points in 4 out of 5 games. So with a team that dominant, there was only one thing that could take them down, and that was, well, Eli Manning. Because after beating their first two opponents by a comfortable amount, the Patriots played in the Super Bowl against the Giants, and famously, Patriots players, including Tom Brady, got a little cocky before the game, saying things like,
"We're only gonna score 17 points."
Okay.
So we go to Super Bowl 42, where David slays Goliath. Eli Manning and the Giants come into the game with a perfect scheme to limit Randy Moss and hit Tom Brady as much as possible. And at the end of the game, the Giants gave Eli Manning a chance to win, and one miracle play and a Plaxico Burress touchdown later, and the mighty Patriots were defeated. Much like the Vikings before them, the Patriots were defeated by a worse team, with the main culprit being one singular fluky play that changed the tide of the entire game. And that may be the case, but in terms of the best team to never win a Super Bowl, maybe greatness should be measured in how close a team got to actually taking home a Super Bowl ring. So with that being said, let's talk about the 1990 Bills. So when we remember the Bills' potential dynasty in the 90s, you usually recall them getting smeared into the turf for 3 straight years by Dallas and Washington, but most people forget that Buffalo's first crack at a Super Bowl was their best chance at winning it, and really, they were robbed of a Lombardi. But we'll get more into that later. Anyways, to set the stage, this Bills roster contained Buffalo's big three on offense, with Hall of Famers Jim Kelly, Thurman Thomas, and Andre Reed, as well as one of the most underrated defenses of all time, with Pro Bowlers all over the place with studs like Daryl Talley, Cornelius Bennett, Shane Conlin, and the all-time sack leader with the first team All-Pro and certified dog, Bruce Smith. This Bills team was just plain dominant, and they led the league in total touchdowns with 52, which, remember, in a slower-paced era of football, was a crazy amount of points back then. So that offense, led by a near 3,000-yard passer, 1,000-yard rusher and receiver, was more than enough to lead the Bills to a modest 13-3 record, which should have been even more impressive had they not lost Jim Kelly for a few games near the tail end of the season. Regardless, this team with the best offense in the entire league and a top 5 defense went into the playoffs and survived a scare from Dan Marino and the Dolphins, a team they had lost to earlier in the season. So after that Dolphins game, people rightfully questioned if this Bills team had what it took to win a Super Bowl. So, in order to silence all the doubters, the Bills woke up on game day and flat out embarrassed the Raiders in the divisional round, dishing out the second biggest blowout in playoff history, beating the Raiders by a laughable 51-3. Please tell me how this score is even real.
Anyway, with some momentum, to say the least, the Bills went into the Super Bowl, where the Giants once again await to ruin every great team's hopes and dreams. Literally, the Giants followed damn near the exact same recipe as they would 17 years later, the only difference being that this guy decided to change teams. Basically, Bill Parcells, defensive coordinator Bill Belichick, and this ragtag Giants team realized they couldn't compete with the talent the Bills had, and decided to run the rock 33 times with a multitude of running backs, including Super Bowl MVP and human bowling ball Otis Anderson. And off the back of this heavy run game, the Giants were able to dominate the time of possession battle with a staggering 40 minutes and 33 seconds to the Bills' mere 19 minutes and 27 seconds. But against all odds, the Bills went down the field and got a manageable look for their kicker Scott Norwood. Ignore the fact that they could have ran one more play before and picked up a few more yards, but that shouldn't matter as long as... Alright, I'm done making this joke. Just roll the damn tape.
No good!
So, with that missed kick, the Giants were crowned as Super Bowl champions, and the Bills' mere taste of Super Bowl defeat would only just begin. But now that you know the analysis of all three of these teams that fell just short, I ask you, are teams like the 1998 Vikings, 2007 Patriots, and 1990 Bills inherently better teams if a kick goes in, or if one singular player doesn't make a miraculous catch, or just one kick sails a little bit more to the left? What truly makes a team great? So if you had to make one pick, which of these three teams do you think is the best NFL team to never win a Super Bowl ring? Comment your answer down below, and if you enjoyed this video, then subscribe and turn on notifications if you think I've earned it. And if you like this video, which if you're still here, then you probably did, then watch this video right here on who is the worst team to win the Super Bowl. Anyways, until next time.